Lots of love. This is your host, Will Donato. Welcome to my 21st Will Donato and Friends show, where we are a forum for artists to showcase and talk about their new projects, mostly through their music. I wanted to thank each and every one of you for tuning into my show. I am so grateful for all your positive comments about the show. Now let's do the show. All right, this is your host, Will Donato, and next our musical adventure takes us to Oakland, California, home of revered Grammy-nominated bandleader, recording artist, painter, and legendary percussionist Pete Escovedo. Pete toured with Santana and was a founding member of Azteca, and he also has 15 studio albums to his credit. Our roving field reporter, the amazing Michael Adam Cohen, sat down with 89-year-old Pete at a farewell tour in San Diego, and this is what transpired. Welcome, Michael, to the show.
Thank you, Will. It's an honor to be a part of your illustrious crew here.
So I'm Michael Adam Cohen here. I'm with Smooth Jazz Live 365.
I'm so excited. We're so glad to have you here, Mr. Pete E. You're the godfather of Latin jazz, it seems like.
And
and percussion. We've enjoyed seeing you over the years. What has been maybe like three or four of your highlight moments over the years? Like your either best performances or something maybe went unexpected but turned into something that you've now taken with you like throughout your career?
Well, I have to go back to when I was younger and just coming up in the business. First of all, I got a chance to meet some very important musicians that I used to listen to. And so back in those days, there was nobody teaching.
Right.
Nobody giving instruction on how to play those instruments, that percussion instrument. So me and my brothers would go to all these clubs listening to these guys mm-hmm. play, and we would watch and we would watch and we would go home and try to do the same thing.
Right. Yeah, it's cool.
So that's how we learned. You know, we was street learning, you know.
Right.
And so those were the highlights of looking up to these guys and actually becoming friends and actually performing together.
Right.
Recording together.
Yeah, so what was that like? That's like a full shift, 360
exactly.
moment, right?
Yeah, it's like
full circle.
You know, how the world revolves.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how it became our turn to be up there with them. So those were very fond memories. And the fact that I played with Santana for 4 years.
That's right, yeah.
It's just so enjoyable because we traveled the world. Mm-hmm. We went all over, and playing with Carlos was always just a great, 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 exciting moment to play with him and be able to record with him. And we had a lot of fun on the road, and it was quite exciting playing in very large venues. Because when I was coming up, mm-hmm. me and my brothers used to just play in small clubs.
Yeah.
And one day, well, he actually joined the band before I did with Santana. And I was playing in a very small room in a hotel, Holiday Inn, mm-hmm. you know, one of those kind of mm-hmm. gigs. Mm-hmm. And he came in and we were talking, hey, glad to have you back in town, man. He goes, yeah. He goes, well, Carlos wants you to join the band. I said, really?
That's he goes, exciting.
Yeah, man, he wants you to come and join the band. So I said, oh, cool, when? He goes, tomorrow.
Oh, boy.
I said, wait a minute, tomorrow? He goes, yeah, we're going to catch a plane to New York, and you're going to play in the band at Madison Square Garden.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
What?
Yeah. That's a huge step up. Yeah.
Oh,
and
man.
Then were you nervous at that point?
I was extremely nervous.
Really?
Extremely nervous.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was great fun. And you know, not used to playing for an enormous crowd like that.
Right.
It was quite an experience for me. But we went on to travel the world and had lots of fun.
So I'm proud that you took that step because, like, some people say, should I do it? Should I not? They also beat themselves up, you know, emotionally in their head. I was wondering what you tell yourself when you're going through something that you're not sure of necessarily. Do you do personalized mantras or, you know?
Well, you
what
know,
do you, how do you, you get know, through those?
It comes to a realization of, you know, you've got to get better
yeah.
in what you do. And so that enabled me to try harder, to be better, a better musician, practice more, you know, make sure that I did my job, what I was supposed to do, as he hired me the job to do, that I was capable of doing that job. So it's just after 4 years of just traveling so much, I miss my home and my family. So I left the band and started my own band.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but it was, you know, those experiences, it's like, it's kind of like taking a step up the ladder, you know, one step at a time to try to get up to a level of where you think you are capable of making a living in this business.
Right. Yeah. Right. And can you talk about now how the business has changed? Because from that to now, where a lot of artists are going independent and doing the marketing and stuff themselves. Do you have anything to say about that? Or?
Yeah, you have to do that nowadays because you got to push yourself. Because a lot of times the promoters and the producers don't do it. There used to be a day where if you signed the record company, they would do everything for you. Well, those times are gone. You don't sign with record companies anymore.
Right.
And a lot of times you do your own record. A lot of musicians have their own studios. They record their own CD and then maybe sell it to one of the big companies. Right. They distribute it.
Right.
So a lot of different things have changed over the years. And for me, the worst thing is that you look at what this band is playing, jazz.
Incredible.
And you don't hear jazz anymore.
Right.
You know? It's completely changed. Now it's, you have to look at a stage and you got to see a woman half dressed.
I hear you there.
A lot of dancing and choreography
and
lights and show and all that
and effects and props and so everything else. Yeah.
So now it's what it looks like rather than what it sounds like.
Right. That's good.
Those guys, you know, Miles Davis, Coltrane, those guys were true musicians, you know.
Exactly.
And you don't hear those guys anymore.
Right. And so don't you have roots from San Diego? Your father or someone? You were raised in San Diego, right?
No, my dad lived here.
Okay.
But I was raised in the Bay Area.
Right, you're in Oakland?
Yeah, in Oakland.
So I used to hear about the stories of your whole family playing drums around, drum circles in the house.
Oh, yeah.
And all that.
Yeah, we did a lot of that. We played the drums all the time. There was a couple of places in the Bay Area. One was Dolores Park.
I love Dolores Park. Yeah, that's cool.
And everybody anybody who had a drum beat on something would go there. We'd all
so play. They have a drum circle?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
And then we also had one at California College there in Berkeley. Did the same thing.
We do it now when there's a full moon. They do a drum circle.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun. We all got together and, the Bay Area was really a place where you could hear so much more music.
Right.
Because there were so many musicians and bands playing. You had the rock scene, San Francisco. Then you had the Brazilian people, the Latin people. There was a lot of music, all the rock bands. And because of Bill Graham and promoting stuff, it was really wide open in those days. Yeah.
So I just want to now talk about your artwork and are you still going to be doing that? I know this is one of your very last performances here in San Diego. We're going to miss you, and that we'll definitely travel to where you go. But I mean, what's next for you, like in your life?
Well, I've been thinking about probably doing another CD, but it's kind of still in the back of my mind. I don't know if I will or have the time to do it, but I've been thinking about doing one more. And my son, Peter Michael, who's the one who's actually booking most of my dates.
Great.
Yeah, so we'll see what he has for me. And he calls me, we kind of pick and choose what we want to do. And then we'll see. I mean, if it runs out by the end of the year, then I'm done.
Okay. Are you looking towards like a collaboration album with other artists, or do you?
Yeah, probably have some special guests.
Yeah,
maybe some of the old guys
that I
played with.
I think that would be really fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
And is there any like any advice or anything you want to give to any upcoming musicians that want to get into like a percussion?
I'm always told that you've got to sacrifice in a sense because. It's your time,
right?
And being in the music business takes a lot of time.
Yeah,
it's something that you have to work on every day.
Right,
and working on it and doing your best, practicing, learning your instrument the best you can, and always, you know, when you get hired, always be on time, do the job you're supposed to do.
That's incredible.
You know, no drinking, no drugs.
Yeah,
You know, be a good guy.
Take it seriously.
And that's important. So, because later on, when you do get to a certain level, the music becomes a business.
Right.
Then you have to learn the business.
And you become a brand.
The business guy.
Yeah.
And now, with great pleasure, we give you Pete Escovedo's Latin Jazz Big Band version of Bobby Caldwell's What You Won't Do for Love, featuring the man himself, Bobby Caldwell. Wow.
I guess you wonder where I've been. I searched to find the love within, and I came back to let you know. Got a thing for you, and I can't let go. My friends wonder what is wrong with me. Well, I'm in the you won't do.
Another great interview, Michael. Thank you so much. What a wonderful track. Amazing performance.